So the topic of the today talk will be about threat intelligence. I'm pretty sure everyone has listened to this word. Everybody is having an idea of, you know, something ambiguous of what threat intelligence is. So I'm Andreas Sfakianakis. I'm an IT security consultant. I was working for the European Union Network Information Security Agency. So I was the author of an incident landscape report. So I was working on the threat intelligence part from a strategic point of view. The last 14 months I moved to UK, so I'm involved. Our clients, ECS clients, are mostly financial institutions. So more or less, to give you a brief overview of the service that ECS provides, we try to identify the threats of our client, the profile the actor, what's happening, the tools and tactics they have to use, identify the infrastructure of our client. Then we try to identify the gaps that we have between, you know, the threats and the infrastructure. We try to identify the gaps and bridge this gap. Then on a daily basis, on a BAU, what we try to do is execute everyday threat intelligence, vulnerability management, monitoring, plus incident response. And then, of course, closing the loop of intelligence, as we will speak later on. We're trying to provide reports and the added value of this whole process. So the roadmap of the discussion and of this talk would be a brief update on the threat landscape. Then we discuss about what is threat intelligence, how we manage this threat intelligence, and what's the process for building this kind of capability. We're going to discuss about threat intelligence platforms, some takeaways from today's talk. So first of all, about threat landscape, one of my favorite reports every year, it's the annual global risk report made by, I think it's produced by World Economic Forum. So these guys are taking into account all risk, not only technological, but also environmental, financial, etc., etc. So they provide this very nice table. So the x-axis is the likelihood, the y it's the impact, and you can see, for example, that in the upper right place we have cyber attacks, which are very close and sure to happen, as water crisis or unemployment. They have identified, in terms of technological risks, a critical infrastructure breakdown. They have also identified that a major risk is data fraud or theft, data theft. And then they have some another technological risk that they have identified. It's all about misuse of technologies. So it was 2 years ago that we have made the work for World Economic Forum. It was all about massive digital misinformation. So how information can be disseminated to all the digital media and, you know, produce some kind of false alerts, causes something that, you know, it's unexpected. The other report that I like on an annual basis, again, it's very towards from an enterprise perspective. It's this Verizon data breach investigation report. We talked about this previously, but what we can see here, it's the number of breaches per threat actor category over time. So what we can see, so we see, for example, that from 2008, we have a huge explosion of the external threat actor categories. So we have so many number of breaches attributed to external threat actors. And this is time that, at this time, the enterprise and the organizations understood the word cyber. So what about cyber? Everybody was frustrated. And we have to, you know, it's something, a threat that we have to manage. And then it's all about cyber. We have the annual ENISA threat landscape report. What we can see here, it's the annual report produced by this European agency. The top threats are identified. It's mostly technical. For example, you see number one threat, it's malicious code, worms, trojans, web-based threats. And then they project and they try to map these threats to some emerging areas. For example, cyber physical systems, mobile computing, big data, Internet of Things, etc. The interesting part from this picture is everything is red, almost everything. And I guess for the next how many years we expect to change any color or not. No, probably. So yes, we have to take into account that these threats are increasing in sophistication, the occurrence is, you know, many more, so we have to do something. And this is where this word threat intelligence came to this world, and everybody is using it. So I will start from the last bullet point. So from my perspective, I was started closely working with threat intelligence and providers the last 14 months. And I'm over baffled about this word. I mean, it's probably the buzzword of 2014. It was 3 days ago that CPNI plus CERT UK, they released a report about threat intelligence, and they said, you know, organizations, there's a lot of providers out there that provide you this kind of intelligence, threat intelligence, but actually, what is it all about? I mean, are they trying to fool you? Can you do it in-house? So they said that we don't, most of the vendors, most of the organizations said that we don't know what it is, but we need it. So one way or another, they are convinced that they need this new trend. So let's go deep dive and understand what actual intelligence is. Intelligence, as we can see, it's the application of knowledge to information. The primary purpose of this intelligence is to inform business decisions regarding the risks and implications that are associated with threats. And something that I like very much, it's this one, that data is not information, information is not knowledge, knowledge is not intelligence, and intelligence is not wisdom. So you see here Batman slapping Robin for, you know, saying the word threat intelligence once more. So. Never again. So let's go and see some of these ones. What's the difference between information and intelligence? So on the one hand, we have information. It's raw, unfiltered feed. You have a feed that's as is. On the other hand, intelligence is something that's processed. Information is unevaluated. Oh, on the other hand, providers that they claim to provide threat intelligence, they have trained analysts and provide, they interpret and analyze all the content before deliver to the customers. Information is also aggregation from virtually every source, while intelligence takes to account only some trusted sources. The information may be true, false, misleading, incomplete, or irrelevant, which is not the case with intelligence. And one very critical point, the last one, that information may not be actionable. Well, intelligence, we want to be actionable. So we have a piece of intelligence, we want to take some action out of it. It's not just, you know, a stale piece of intelligence and information, and we cannot do anything about this. Again, some characteristics of intelligence. Must be accurate, must be timely. I don't care if I get information about an APT group, but it's, you know, 3 months after I got hacked, so it doesn't make sense. Must be relevant. So for example, financial sector may have different requirements in terms of intelligence, or maybe different threat actors target financial institutions from energy sector, let's put it like this. Must be tailored. Predictive, if it can be predicted, it can be, and of course, must be actionable, meaning easily integrated with our security controls and our processes. So another point is why we need, after all, this kind of threat intelligence. Everybody's discussing about threat intelligence, but why we need it? So first of all, we see almost every day a new data breach, new attack method, new attack pattern. The threat landscape is kind of dynamic. So everybody wants to, and should be in the community, should be up to date about all this dynamic nature of our job. Everybody wants to have some kind of situational awareness, meaning that, as we told previously, different sectors have different threats. We should defend better by, we can defend better by knowing the adversary. So if the APT stands for Advanced Persistent Threat, if the attacker is advanced, why not our defenses are not advanced as well? So we want to know in advance how we can, you know, tackle all these threats. And We have to go from a mentality from a security and defensive perspective, from a mentality from reactive to proactive. So now the case was that, okay, we deep dive in our logs, we detect a data breach, but we have to go the other way. We have to have information intelligence before the hack or the data breach occurs. And after all, what is all about? It's all about context. So context, as it's one of my takeaways, that when, for example, an analyst has an alert he wants to, or is involved in a digital investigation, he has to know and have context about this IP address, about this threat actor, about this domain. He wants to know everything that's related to a piece of the object that he's analyzing. And of course, in a more strategic view, threat intelligence can drive better investment strategies, not only for incident response, but also for the senior executives. They want to know, for example, if their customers in a specific area are more targeted than others, about geopolitical information and all this stuff. What are the two types of threat intelligence? So far we had more or less the information provided, the intelligence provided by the providers, it's twofold. The one is strategic and tactical, or tactical is also known as operational. So what do we mean by tactical? Tactical is actually pieces of intelligence that are human readable. So we can say, for example, that a report by Kaspersky, a PDF, it's a piece about a specific threat actor. It's a strategic piece of intelligence, which means that was created by humans, can be consumed by humans. The delivery time may take days or months based on the effort of the analyst to deliver this piece of intelligence. Can be, the useful lifespan can be long because they can store it and have it as reference for this specific actor group. And mostly the focus of this strategic intelligence is for planning and decisions. Whereas in the tactical, it's mostly where I am involved so far in my everyday operations. So we receive information that can be readable by humans, by machines, and human or machines. So it's mostly indicators, just like IP addresses, domains, malware hashes, and all the stuff that can characterize an object of interest. So we get all of them, we need, and we have to act and respond upon receiving such a piece of intelligence. So we're receiving a malware hash, we have to go back and search all our workstations if this malware hash is found in them. So in terms of, we want to build, to have this kind of capability, we want this capacity building, but how we start? So now, more and more organizations have started to be involved in this kind of journey. I call it journey from my perspective because it's something that's not built from one day to another. It's something that you have to get more and more mature. It involves technology, people and processes. So it's something that you have to build. And you will see some models or frameworks that I'm going to present that are derived, and they come from law enforcement, from intelligence agencies, from military, from military sector. So all of these models and frameworks are moving to cyber now and trying to understand how we can make full use of this threat intelligence. So let's discuss about this one. So how do we build it? Capacity building in terms of threat intelligence. This is the glorious intelligence cycle. So let's read the bullet points here. Fundamental cycle of intelligence processing. It comes from military intelligence agency or law enforcement, and it's actually a closed loop. So how do we start? Actually, we have to set up our requirements. We have to make our planning and direction, meaning that we have this money to spend, we have this requirement, probably our target comes from X country, so probably we're going to focus mostly on this one and this part of the client, of our customers. So we just, first of all, we have to set the requirements. Then it's all about information collection. So information collection can be done using our system. We can pay a provider to give us data. And this is how we collect data. After collecting data, of course, we have to process them and analyze them. So we get the data. We have to apply some knowledge on this data in order to do some, to have some kind of analysis and produce some intelligence. When we do the analysis and the production of the intelligent species, we have to disseminate them. Dissemination means if they are indicators of compromised technical data, we can disseminate them to our security controls, meaning firewalls, meaning IDS, IPS, meaning proxies, proxy servers, or it can be a piece of report, a PDF report that can be provided to the senior executives or to public. Upon disseminating the intelligence that we have provided, it's time to close the loop. So we have to ask and get feedback of that, is the source that we got all the information trusted? Should we, in the next phase, should we take the source to account or lower the confidence of the source? Was the analysis done correctly? What are we missing the loop? So it's something that goes all the time and we have to take care of it. So this is the famous intelligence cycle. Everybody should be reassessed, to do the threat assessment again and again and again in order to make it better. The next concept, it's the well-known in the security community, it's the pyramid of pain. So, what does this mean? Is that, for example, you see at the bottom of the pyramid, malware hashes, and at the top of the top of the pyramid, TTPs, which stands for tactics, techniques, and procedures. So, the value of an indicator is that if we get a piece of intelligence, for example, a hash value, how easily we can respond and deny to the attacker this kind of indicator. So he has to change his tactic. So if we have the intelligence of the attacker that he's using this malware hash, from the attacker perspective, it's very easy to just, you know, recompile the file. You know, now we use polymorphism, and you know, it's very trivial for the attackers to just, for the same binary, to change a hash value. Of course, so it's very trivial for this one. In order to change IPs and domains, the attacker, it's pretty easy and simple. He has the infrastructure, probably he has already access to compromised PCs or proxies or cloud distances. So it's very easy from his side to change domains and IP addresses. Network and host artifacts plus tools. Then the attacker starts to feel a little bit uncomfortable about, okay, somebody's trying to intercept me, so I have to change some basic parts of my operations. And then if you have intelligence about the TTP, as a defender, if you have intelligence about the TTPs of an attacker, and when we say actually TTP, we mean the modus operandi, meaning how they work from the very first time, from the very first phase that they target you until the very last time that they exfiltrate data and do their objectives. So if you know how they work and you have this piece of intelligence, it's very tough for them to change it. So this stands for the attackers, but it's also very difficult to get all this information intelligence from a defender perspective, from a threat intelligence provider perspective. For example, a threat intelligence provider can very easily identify and gather IP addresses that are malicious, are marked as malicious, but it's very difficult for the provider to get all this stuff, because sometimes you need some involvement in gray area zones. So you have to probably interact with the attacker, may need to, you know, it involves sometimes human intelligence, not only, you know, cyber, but also we go to other types of intelligence as well. So for example, there are some threat intelligence providers that have, I don't know, 200, 500 people all over the world and have physical access or physical communication interaction with actual hackers. So this is the well-known pyramid of pain. Then, okay, we have all this kind of we're starting building our threat intelligence capability, but how we embed this type of capability and proactive mentality in our organization. So it's this vendor has provided this very nice diagram and flow that I like to very much, and I always propose it and I always present in my presentations. So what do you have? You have your sources, can be either strategic or tactical. Excuse me. And then this information is go to the intelligence. Excuse me, to the intelligence analyst. We try to analyze the content and provide information and disseminate the output of this intelligence analysis to the prevention or detection. Then the triage is going to the security operations center. The response is done. If successfully done and nothing else needed, it goes to lessons learned and tactical intelligence. So all the indicators are stored somewhere for a future reference. Then probably after the response, some analysis, containment, collection is needed. And this is more or less the workflow that a mature organization should use. And you have to take into account, for example, that these threat intelligence sources, you say, can be tactical, but can be also strategic. Strategic means that maybe a PDF report that has nothing to do with technical indicators and all this stuff. So probably this strategic intelligence analysis can be fed to other functions, meaning security architecture, can mean senior executives about a specific threat, about a specific incident, etc. And the other interesting model, it's the whole about kill chain, which was analyzed by, it was first introduced, I think, during 2011 by Lockheed Martin. So it's derived from military. So kill chain is a phase-based model to describe the stages of an attack, which also helps inform ways to prevent such attacks. So more or less what says that if an attacker is targeting you, first of all, the first phase, it's the recon phase. So he tried to identify your digital footprint, whatever information can find from open source intelligence, LinkedIn, Facebook, your home address, whatever, email accounts, or send, you know, empty emails just to identify valid email addresses. Then after the recon phase, it's the weaponization. It's the phase where he works on his payload. He thinks that this payload and this exploit will hit you. You are vulnerable to this exploit. So it's how he prepares his toolset. Then it's the delivery phase. The delivery phase can be how his payload arrives to you, meaning this can arrive by email. He can make a drive-by download to a web page, and you know, to a web page that you visit frequently, so he can compromise you. Then the actual hack of your system is in this exploitation phase. After the exploitation phase, it's the installation phase. Installation means that he tries to maintain access to your system. He can want to do it in a shadow way, not to detect him. One before the end, it's the command and control phase. So he got access and maintained this access to your system. So he tries to contact the command and control server to inform the server that, okay, now I got him, give me commands of what to do next. And then it's action on the objectives, which can mean going back here and further exploit the whole organization or whatever. So until now we were in this, so the data breach happens here. So until now the mentality was discover everything post-exploitation. Now, as the threat intelligence capability of an organization goes more mature and mature, we claim, or they claim, that they can detect before being exploited. So if one threat actor is looking for you, is searching for your digital footprint, you can identify this kind of campaign here. So it's much more safer because you're not exploited, you detect the attack in the early phases. And some companies also, if they detect something in post-exploitation phases, they regard it as a failure because they said have invested so much money, so we are that many money, so we are, you know, confident that we can detect almost everything in the first stages. In terms of sources, the sources that you can get intelligence, first of all internal, okay, you have a workstation compromised, so you have to investigate and see what's happened with this workstation. According to the forensics analysis, you have some insider threats that probably you have to, some insiders that look suspicious, so you have keep a better eye on them. Behavioral analysis, so generally speaking, internal honeypots. So generally speaking, you can have a valuable source of information, and all of this stuff can come from your own organization. Then it's open source intelligence. So there are a lot. If you search for indicators of compromise out there in the internet, you can find lots and lots of URLs providing compromised URLs, compromised hosts, IP that seem suspicious, IPs that are responsible for spam sending. You can find whatever you want. I mean, I can give you about one or 200 sources of this kind of intelligence. They're free. You don't need to pay them. But the problem with this one is that or phishing URLs, so you know, phishing about Lloyd's, for example, so you can go and see how a phishing site looks like. So this kind of, it's good to have, and we have to collect all this information, but sometimes all this information comes without context. So we say, monitor this kind of IP address, we have a intelligence that this IP address is suspicious, but if we have an alert about this IP address, we don't know what these threats look like. We don't have any context about this one. So they're free, they're open, it's good to have, but they don't provide context, and you know, it's up to us how to make full advantage, full use of them. And you can see, for example, the overlap between some of the feeds. An analysis was done by ML Security, and you see that the overlap is almost, it's minimal. So what you have to do, you have to collect all of them just for future reference or for monitoring. For example, if you're interested for phishing, of course you're gonna have a phishing feed, and you're gonna have it in monitoring mode and identify any potential threats. But generally speaking, the overlap is minimal, so you have to keep track of everything. And as we said, the famous quote from Lord of the Rings, one does not simply dump all indicators into production. So you get all these feeds, you cannot put them into production and monitor everything, because your SOC analyst will deep dive in a sea of, you know, a flood of alerts. So we have experienced this one, lots of false positives, so we have to analyze them before put them in production and provide real alerts. So it's the open source on the one hand. On the other hand, it's all about threat intelligence providers. So I don't know if you can identify some of them. What's happening with the threat intelligence providers? So it's just like it's a race, more or less, that ended in this. It's the game nowadays. So these guys claim, for example, that my threat intel can beat your threat intel. I have many more indicators than what you have. But the truth is that this kind of industry and market is kind of immature. So it's in its initial phase. Let's put it like this. So they have a different focus, other focus on phishing, other focus on APTs, other focus on APTs in Russia, other focus on financial Trojans and botnet takedowns. So you have to know what are you going to ask, to whom you're going to refer to in order to get their intelligence. So they have different focus, they have different expertise, they provide different type of intelligence, meaning probably some of them provide PDFs and reports, strategic intelligence, while others provide CSVs with IP addresses with some context. And because it's the whole market is new, you can see that a lot of these providers are driven by client needs. So they ask, what do you want? You want APT? I will give you APT. Or you want this kind of format? I will give you STIX format or CSV format or TXT format, whatever. So this is the case for the market. Of course, there's a lot of potential, but not for now, it's kind of you know, immature. And what they provide, some tactical, some strategic, and for some examples of tactical feeds, intelligence are threat indicator feeds or cryptolocker analysis, for example, while on the other hand, the strategic ones are executive briefings, campaign analysis, a campaign about an APT group, and industry-specific threat assessments. So, ideally, the most mature ones are somewhere here that provide both strategic and tactical. So, as we said previously, you have internal sources, open source, threat intelligence sources, you have the commercial ones, and then you have all about information sharing. So what's happening? Among organizations, but even within an organization, we have silos. And this is something that we, for example, the financial sector, it's FSI's approach to promote information sharing and do this kind of silo breaking activities. And we'll present you how this is going to happen. So a lot of organizations find great value from intelligence shared among other organizations or even among departments of the same organization. So the proposal is to, you know, break the silos and share information as much as you can. And I have a nice quote here. We share about the same speed that George Martin writes novel. So for now, the sharing frequency is not very, very high. And of course, another quote that I like very much is, you cannot automate trust. You have to have some, you know, person relationship and build trust relationships with your peer organizations. So we discussed all about the intelligence, but where this intelligence lives? I mean, where do we store all this intelligence? So in a Nirvana state, we store all of them in a threat intelligence platform. So we have information about articles that are related to indicators. We have intelligence from commercial feeds, from open source feed. We have enrichment services, quiz information, passive DNS information. And everything is stored in a single platform. People are interacting with this platform, which can be incident response, fraud analyst, threat analyst, security operations center analysts, management executives, malware analysts, help desk. So you see that different roles are interacting with this platform. So they have different needs in terms of GUI, in terms of what they're looking for. Then we have processes, circle of trust sharing. So probably one department does not want to share information with some other department, even within the same organization. We have workflows, communication, fraud. And of course, we have technology, always people, process, and technology. We have technology, so whatever is stored here should be forwarded to next generation firewalls, to web proxies, etc. in an automated way or after the manual analysis of the analysts. So the threat intelligence platform is the place where everything is collected and stored, analyzed, enriched, and disseminated, and then provide visualizations, analytics, and is shared within the organization or, you know, from one organization to another peer organization. So imagine that this is a central platform that everybody can do, these people can do all these operations. However, I stole this slide from another expert. So if you replace the word army with threat intelligence platform, this is the state where we live now. So there is no single threat intelligence platform that can satisfy all our requirements and all our needs. And if you see the landscape of the threat intelligence platforms that they exist so far, some of them are, I think some of them are, you know, 2 or 3 months old, not more. They provide their service quite expensively, and as you know, since we're hosted by Plymouth University and we're in favor of open source and community-based efforts, I will present how, for example, these two platforms, Mitre CRITS, which is the open source solution that's provided by Mitre, plus SoulThreads, that it's the platform that is promoted by F.S. Isaac. And I'm going to show you how this works. So we have CRITS. This is the big threat intelligence platform. Everything is stored according to some formats. You see, CAPEC, MIC, there are some standardized formats in order to discuss about this. And you store all your external feeds, your internal feeds, and you analyze them and store them in a standardized format. Upon the analysis, you can provide information about indicators, observables, domains, IPs, threat actors, etc. So this is CRITS, which stands for Collaborative Research into Threats. And this is SaltRedge that is provided by FS Isaac. So what we have a hacker targeting a financial institution. The incidents, the security incident is analyzed and then provided to FS Isaac SOC and then disseminated to all the other financial institutions. What happens next if the same attacker tries to attack another financial institution is all already blocked because the information is automatically transferred to all the other financial institutions that are member of FS Isaac. What's common in CRITS and SaltRedge is that they use STIX and TAXII, which are, let's say, the problem today is that we don't have a common vocabulary to describe a threat. So this need came from the need for security automation came from this fact. So we have all these sources. They all went to the analyst. The analyst is DDoSed and flooded, so he couldn't take care of all of the information and intelligence that was done and forwarded to all the security controls. And of course, it was all the intelligence was coming in different formats. So instead of having all these different formats, now we have one simple standard that we can describe the whole information. So for example, these are the objects that the common standard has, which is the language to communicate a threat. So this is the observable. What activity are you seeing? What are the indicators? Was it part of a bigger incident? What are the TTPs, the tactics of the threat experiencing? What to try to exploit? Was it your CEO? Was it senior executives? Was it part of a bigger campaign? What was the threat actor and what course of indication of action should I make? I mean, block it in that firewall, block it in the blue code proxy or whatever. And you can see that using this standard, you can have all these relationships and take the full story of a security incident and a threat. Of course, currently, STIX and TAXII, these two protocol standards that are the most promising ones, are under trial phase. But clients are pushing the vendors to speak all of them, to make their products speak this STIX and TAXII format. So some takeaways from what we discussed today, it's that current state of intelligence is initial, but has a great potential. Again, as I told various times during the presentation, that context is critical. It makes everyone's job and life easier, from executives to security analysts. Intelligence-led defense has significant operating costs, so we want to move, as we said, from reactive to proactive culture in information security and response, but this always comes with a cost. And this cost probably will not be covered, and this gap will not be covered by intelligence providers so all alone, so we don't have to blindly invest in intelligence. First, of course, we have to think of the requirements, and there's always a talk and discussion about do it yourself or buy it. We said that there's a lot of activity in the community in terms of tools and standards and automation stuff. So always we have to keep an eye on automation and tool developments. And of course, finally, the bullet point is do not never forget. It's not only technology, it's not only machines, it's always people and processes.